Usually when you hear about a project relicensing, it is a cause for concern because usually it's something to be concerned about. The project decides, we are going to be proprietary now, or we're going to go from this open source license to this open core weird sort of license, which kind of looks open source, but doesn't have the same level of rights. It is not often you hear a project going from a permissive license like the MIT license to a copyleft license like GPL v3 or later, but that is exactly what we're talking about today. ForgeGo is now copyleft, just like Git. For anyone who doesn't know, ForgeGo is a SourceForge, much like GitHub, GitLab, SourceHut, Gitty, things like that. It is basically a bit of software you host on a server, maybe your own server, and it is used to manage your Git repos, to collaborate on them. You've used GitHub or GitLab before, you know exactly how this works. Now, Gitty has a special place in the history of ForgeGo because ForgeGo only started existing in 2022 when it forked off of the Gitty project after there was a community election and the then elected owners of the project decided to transfer the domains and the trademark of Gitty over to a for-profit company, which then led to a big open letter where they're like, hey, is this a mistake? Like, why did you do this? Could you please just go and move this into a non-profit and have the non-profit run by the community? The for-profit company didn't really want to do that. This led to a fork. That fork became ForgeGo. Now, the main bulk of the post is, how is this going to affect me, or I guess you? And for the average user who is just a developer who wants to go and host their source code, who just wants to go and run ForgeGo, who maybe wants to compile it and update it and use it on Debian or Arch or Ubuntu or anything else out there, for most people, literally nothing changes. The license isn't going to affect you in any single way. For people distributing it, there are going to be some subtle changes though. Now, previously, with it being an MIT project, there's not really that many requirements for distribution. Basically, just make sure the license is present somewhere, and that's pretty much it. Like, there's no requirements regarding the source code or anything else like that. GPL v3 or later, there are a couple of things you need to do. If you are redistributing ForgeGo binaries, for example, because you are packaging it for a Linux distribution or some specific container or package format, you are now required to provide the full source of your ForgeGo variant, including potential modifications, under the same license terms as ForgeGo itself. Now, if you're packaging it for a distro, most distros out there just provide the source code for everything if it's available anyway. Doesn't matter if it's GPL v3 or later, GPL v2, MIT, BSD, most distros have somewhere on their site. In some cases, they distribute the source code alongside the binary, but is gonna be there somewhere. Like, that's not really something you really have to think about that much. If you're doing container and packaging stuff, I can't really comment on the different repos out there, but once again, not that difficult to do. The easiest thing to do is, if you have a modified version, just link to the repo where it's stored. You could do more complex things like, ooh, send us a letter, we'll give you a CD or something, but like, unless you're a big company trying to avoid giving out source code, it's just easier to link to a repo. Some people get confused by this and think there needs to be a publicly accessible repo. That's not the case. It needs to be a sensible way to distribute source code, but there is a spectrum of sensible, and one side of the spectrum is more annoying than the other. Moving on, you are free to sell ForgeGo services, including hosting it for others. If you act according to our values and ensure your users receive the freedoms ForgeGo grants you, it is unlikely you have to do adjustments to your business now or in the future. There are two different ways you can interpret this. One is, if you respect the license, you don't have to adjust anything. The other way you can interpret this, which is not what they have the power to do, is if you do something that they don't like, you're hosting somebody that they think is a terrible person, that they could then stop you doing that. They couldn't do that. What they could do is say, well, you have bugs, you have features that you want added, we're just not going to add those into the main repo. This next bit is not talking about you as a regular individual home user, but you as someone at a company or maybe runs a company. You might have chosen to avoid copyleft software, for example, because it is discouraged in your company. However, Forge.io depends on Git, one of the most successful copyleft software. Both Forge.io and Git must be used together, either as individual binaries or bundled into the official container images. The license of Git is GNU GPL v2, another version of the same copyleft license. Look, some people would disagree with that framing. Yes, they are different versions of the GNU GPL, but they are very, very different licenses, which we don't have time to get into today. Although the Forge.io codebase includes basic support for GoGit, a Go package distributed under a permissive license that can be used in place of Git, it is not supported or packaged because it is not fully compatible and could corrupt Git repos. Basically, this is a Go re-implementation of Git, and a lot of it is there. But there is a number of things which aren't, which, like cherry pick, for example, that's kind of a big one, which could very well end up breaking things. At some point, this is going to be a perfect re-implementation, but we're not at that point. So why the license change? Well, this isn't something that just happened overnight. And I'll read this section first and then talk about it because it's really weirdly phrased. Developers who choose to publish their work under a copyleft license are excluded from participating in software that is published under a permissive license. That is at the opposite of the core values of the Forge.io project. And in June 2023, it was decided to also accept copylefted contributions. A year later, in August 2024, the first pull request to take advantage of this opportunity was proposed and merged. This first sentence is the part that I had to reread like 5 or 10 times to really understand what it was trying to say. It is talking about two separate licenses, not just the license of the project, but the license of the code you were submitting to the project. Basically, what it's trying to say here is if you have a project licensed under a permissive license like the MIT license, you cannot accept contributions that are licensed under a copyleft license like the GPL style license, because those GPL contributions don't have the same level of permissive rights that are available in an MIT license. So you can't say the entire thing is MIT because there's this one little bit that's actually a lot more restrictive. The way most projects get around this is they just dual license. They say this part is MIT, this part is GPL. There's no problem there. Now, the same issue does not apply in reverse. If you have a copyleft project in GPL v3 or later, you can accept contributions licensed under MIT because MIT is a lot more permissive, and sticking that into a GPL code base doesn't try to expand out what the MIT license code lets you do. And that GPL license doesn't try to expand out what you're allowed to do with the code. In fact, it does the opposite and restricts it. In other words, you can turn an MIT code base into a GPL code base, but unless you have all of the contributors agree or you replace their code, you cannot then turn a GPL code base back into an MIT code base. Now, the second paragraph feels like it should have been split in two. A copyleft license makes reusing other copyleft software easier. Recently, we discovered that some of the dependencies we used were incompatible with the license Forge.io was distributed with, and they had to be removed for now. Choosing copyleft licenses enables us to reuse more work and save us precious time to focus on improving Forge.io itself. This bit in the middle probably should have been its own separate paragraph. The way that this is framed makes it seem like it's talking about a GPL dependency that is incompatible with the MIT license they had before, when in fact that's not really what it's talking about. What it's actually talking about is initially they found a non-free dependency being used in the Forge.io project, that being Vuebar Graph, which depends on GSAP, an external thing you have to sign up for to get access to the full premium edition. Later on, some other things were found as well. Siteproc.js under the CPAL, an MPL derivative, or AGPL, and also Elk.js under the Eclipse license. Now again, those can be used if you say that specific part is licensed under this license, everything else is MIT. But going back to the thing from before, if you want the entire project to be an MIT project, it needs to all be compatible with the terms of the MIT license. Now, the parts surrounding that are kind of like a yes and no kind of situation. A copyleft license doesn't necessarily make reusing other copyleft software easier, because these licenses do still have some incompatibilities, and whilst they might not be as massive as between a permissive license and GPL v3, you can't just say, well, I have this copyleft code and this copyleft code, they're just perfectly compatible. You do still need to understand the terms of the license. Ultimately, the easiest thing to do is just have a multi-license model and just explain exactly how each of the things are licensed. I will agree with this final point though. Copyleft licenses do not only benefit the developers, they also guarantee freedoms to users of the software. They reduce the risk of exploitative business practices like creating a modified version of Forge Joe with less freedoms to the users, which could ultimately trap users in a vendor lock-in. I have a feeling, whilst they haven't done so yet, that a lot of people on the team are still very salty about Gitty and are still worried about that happening over on that project. And a part that I find very amusing is the license of Forge Joe is not carved in stone, and this change shows that it can adapt to the needs of the project. It also shows that it is a long process. It took months of discussion to reach the agreement in 2023 and a year for it to be put to use. This slow pace reflects how difficult it is to make a sound decision knowing it will have a long-lasting impact. Well, again, this is kind of like a one-way conversion. Without agreement from the contributors who are now submitting GPL v3 code or compatible license code, you can't then turn those contributions back into MIT code. So now that they have made this change, going back on it would be incredibly difficult. You could just do a license and the problem isn't there. Now, there is still an ongoing discussion about the change, about what licenses are actually compatible with this change. Like, okay, is AGPL v2 compatible? Is AGPL v3 compatible? What about this license? What about that license? And as is the case in most FOSS projects, most people are not lawyers. So most people are kind of just like guessing and winging it and like reading the documentation that is available there, but not fully comprehending it. I'm in the same boat as well, right? Like, I am not a lawyer. I am just reading things and understanding the way that I understand them. It's very possible there is some misinterpretation I have, but yeah. As of the 9.0 release, they are going to be GPL v3 or later. Obviously, the older releases are gonna stay under the old license. You don't see any change, you don't acknowledge any change. So if you liked the video, go like the video. And if you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe, and Libera link in the description down below. If you like, let me know your favorite license down below. Yeah, do that.